Now, as we've been going through Romans, I've used this expression about wanting to make sure we are clear about the forest, you know, the big picture, as we look at these individual trees each week and where we are in that forest, in that argument of Paul through Romans, is he's not yet talking about the salvation that is found through Jesus Christ, the forgiveness of sins before God through his blood, but rather emphasizing that all people will face judgment. And in that judgment, God will not play favorites. He will be completely impartial. And we are seeing also that no one can stand the test of God's judgment, in other words, with a passing grade. And we have also seen a division between the Jew and the Gentile. The Jew, the people of Israel, and they were given special revelation from God. They were given, of course, many things, the prophets, temple and all, but ultimately they were given the law. That's our focus today. The law, we call it the law of Moses. It's the law of God given to Moses. And Moses, again, then to give to the people of Israel as they were about to start life as a new nation in the promised land that God was giving them, having delivered them from Egypt. So that's Israel, and then there's everybody else in the world, and they're all called the Gentiles. Now, the Gentiles did not have that same degree of revelation that Israel had received. But they were with a revelation from God nonetheless, and that is through creation, because wherever you live, wherever on the globe, whenever in history, you can always look to the sun, you can always look to the moon, the stars, look around you at the trees and the animals and the bodies of water and the rivers and so forth, you know that there's a creator. There's an all-powerful, immortal creator, and you can call him God, the creator. But you at least have that degree of revelation. And so whether you are a Jew or whether you are a Gentile, you know something about God. And therefore, again, God's judgment will apply to you. So we're looking at verses 12 through 16, as I said, and I'm going to read them slightly out of order. If you're in a New King James translation, which is what I use up here, or if you have the Old King James, or there are a few other translations, the publishers helped you out. Because you'll notice there is a parenthesis at the start of verse 13 and at the end of verse 15, bracketing off those verses as a parenthetical, a sort of an aside, just like we do when we're writing. And again, they're not in the Greek or anything, so not every Bible necessarily chose to do that, but they are in the flow of thought. So starting at verse 12, and of course this is flowing right after verse 11 from last week, there's no partiality with God. Verse 12 tells us, "For as many as have sinned without law will also perish without law, and as many as have sinned in the law will be judged by the law," now drop down to verse 16, "in the day when God will judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ according to my gospel," or the gospel I'm telling you about. So that's the idea. Whether the Jew or the Gentile, in other words, whether you have the law or not, you're going to face judgment. Now let's look at that section that's in the parentheses, verses 13 through 15. Notice, "For not the hearers of the law are just in the sight of God, but the doers of the law will be justified. For when Gentiles who do not have the law by nature do the things in the law, these, although not having the law, are a law to themselves, who show the work of the law written in their hearts, and their conscience also bearing witness, and between themselves their thoughts accusing or else excusing them." So, it's not about knowing the law, memorizing the law, reading the law, teaching the law. It's about doing the law. Who cares if you've memorized all the commandments if you disobey them every day? And so that's the key, doing the law. Now, as I said, the law is a reference to the law of Moses. But we must remember when we're talking about the law of Moses that it was a very complex thing that God gave the people. It was given to them to rule their lives. They were not going to have a Congress or a parliament or something like that. They were not going to even have a king. Now, eventually they did have a king, but God's original intention for them was not to be ruled by any government of that sort, but to be ruled by God, and his law would explain how that rule would work within the nation. So there is a lot in the law that we might call the civil aspects of how society in Israel was supposed to run. For example, what was my obligation if I saw my neighbor's animal out loose from the yard, just going down the street? Did I have an obligation at all? Well, the law explained how God wanted the society to run. What is the obligation if my animal gets out of my yard and bites somebody? What am I responsible for? How do we handle that? And so there's a lot like that in there. Hey, if I just got married, am I exempt from military service, active duty for a certain period of time? That's in there. Things like that. And this is why, as an aside, when you come into people who really are critical and frankly just hate the things of God and the Bible, and you're trying to make a stand on a moral point before God in our society, say, this is wrong, and you're trying to take a stand for morality, and then they shoot back at you, it's like, oh, I guess you think we ought to have a law that bans shellfish, huh? Because that's in the Bible too. And you see, in saying that foolish remark, it's showing their ignorance. Because yes, the Bible does talk about issues like what the Jews were to eat and what they were not to eat, what sort of clothing they were to wear, linens and mixed linens and all that kind of stuff. That is in there, but that was specifically to make them distinct from all the other people. God wanting Israel also to be a witness to those Gentiles. How come you guys don't eat the shellfish? How come you guys don't eat pork? Well, because our God has told us not to. Your God, who's he? And you see, it's an opportunity for a witness. So those are part of their civil society, but that's not a moral thing. Likewise, in the law, there was the laying out of punishments. How do we treat someone who steals? Do we cut off his hand? Or is there maybe something else not quite as severe? And that's laid out in the law. How do we deal with someone who murders somebody versus someone who accidentally causes the death of another, what we call in our law manslaughter, those distinctions? All of that's laid out, you see. But then, still in the law of Moses, there were those moral standards of the law. And that's the focus here in reference to the Gentiles. The moral standards of the law as seen in the commandments, like saying you're not supposed to murder in the first place. You're not supposed to steal in the first place. You're not supposed to lie and bear a false witness against your neighbor. Oh yeah, I saw that guy, you know, do something. He said, what do you mean? I didn't do anything. Well, I saw it. You know, no, you're not supposed to do that. Children are to respect their parents. And we recognize, don't we, that all people throughout history in any sort of societies, I mean, it might be a very primitive village, it might be a very advanced, large city, but wherever men and women live together in some sort of organized society, we see a constant, don't we, on those commands. Whatever society you're talking about, they don't allow people to just start murdering each other. You're not allowed to just take someone else's stuff or just, you know, help yourself to a guy's wife. And children are expected to respect parents. You know, those type of laws are found in all sorts of societies and punishment thereof. God said, hey, this is how we're going to punish it in Israel, but all societies have that in common. Why? Why would all these Gentiles who have never heard of the law of Moses, never been exposed to it, why would they have so much in common with what the law of Moses says? And it goes back to the word that we saw here. We also read it when we were reading in Hebrews chapter 10 And that is the issue of conscience. A conscience. Now, we hear often, and I say it often, that we must have a biblical worldview. Sometimes it seems, when I hear people say have a biblical worldview, their whole focus is on prophecy and end times events. And, you know, if you got a biblical worldview, you'll understand what's happening in Israel. And you've got to, and I'm not denying that. That's very valid. That's a part of a biblical worldview, absolutely. But a biblical worldview is greater than just prophecy and current events and so forth. We talked earlier in our study in Romans about an aspect of a biblical worldview is recognizing that God created the heavens and the earth and everything within them. That life does not exist as an accidental collection of chances that evolved over a long period of time to happen to produce life, as atheistic Darwinian evolution would teach. No, we have a creator, specifically designed life, gave life and created everything that we see, whether it be living like other animals, plants, and so forth, or the non-living, the rocks, the bodies of water, the planets, and so forth. But the thing about the creation evolution issue, and when we were talking about that, I said there have been many Bible-believing scientists who made great discoveries in the past, who believed in the Creator. And we owe them a great debt for what they brought to civilization in terms of how our world works and their discoveries. But we also recognize, don't we, that there's a lot of atheists and unbelievers, or maybe other religions, that have also made scientific discoveries. And when you bring the discoveries that have been made and you bring it down into day-to-day life, and for example, let's think in terms of medicine, and let's say that you need surgery, whether or not your surgeon is a believer in Jesus Christ, or for that matter, believes in creation versus evolution, doesn't really matter in the sense that for that surgery, there is going to be a way that that surgery is done. And a believing doctor or an atheistic doctor or a Hindu or a Muslim or whatever, they're going to all do it the same way because this is how it's done. It's like needing a plumber. You know, there's not the spiritual way to fix the pipe. There's the way to fix the pipe. And so while it's always nice to, you know, work with other believers, it's great if you've got a doctor who's another Christian and all that, that's all great. But again, from a practical standpoint, it's not as significant. Oh, but where it is significant is in other important areas, like the area of psychology. And this is why I talk about a biblical worldview. Because while it may not matter if your surgeon, your dentist, your plumber believes in creation or evolution or believes in Jesus Christ or some other religion or no religion at all, that may not matter in terms of you. But if you're talking about the field of psychology, having a biblical worldview is crucial if you, as the Christian, are in need. So someone says, hey, you know a good plumber? You don't say, well, this guy's a believer. Like, that's the important thing. But if someone's saying, I need a psychologist, I need a therapist, if you're a believer, you want to find one who shares your worldview. Now, I know that there are those who are professional enough that they're not going to undermine your beliefs. They're not going to torpedo or try to talk you out of what you believe, but they're just not going to be as capable. Why? Because we must understand what the Bible says about who we are, not just as created beings by God, but affected by sin. And the fact that every human being has a sin nature. That is not affirmed by our world. And if it's not affirmed, then it's going to lead astray in those areas. And now I go back to the issue of conscience. Hey, everybody knows that we have a conscience. That's not some Christian teaching. People talk about the conscience, and even the word conscience, it means with knowledge. That's the idea, because science means knowledge. And con, that little preposition, is often the idea of with something. It's part of words that have that. With knowledge. And that's the idea of a conscience, isn't it? I respond to my conscience because I have the knowledge of this is right or this is wrong. And that's what Paul was talking about. Their conscience is either what? Accusing them, shouldn't have done that, or it's excusing them in the sense it's like affirming, like, yeah, that was the right thing to do. So we all have this conscience. But here's what also we recognize, and I think C.S. Lewis dove into this in his book, Mere Christianity. Isn't it fascinating that among humanity, there are things that we will do that we know are the right thing to do, even though they risk harm to ourselves, when supposedly we're all trying to survive. So why would I ever put myself in harm's way just to do the right thing? And I believe the example he used was trying to save a drowning person, diving into that water, risking your own life because it's the right thing to do, being brave in that regard, even though it seems to go certainly against evolutionary principles, where you just survive at all cost so that you can advance on. So let's think about that for a moment. Why is that? If, let's use that illustration. Let's say you're all by yourself, you're fishing at some river or creek or whatever, there's no one else around, and here comes this child going down the river, screaming, crying, saying, help, help. And you know you're going to jump in and try to do something to help that child. You're not just going to stand there and watch them go by. And if anyone does stand there and watches them go by, what's their conscience going to be doing to them throughout the rest of the day? And frankly, in the days and weeks and months and maybe the rest of their life. It's going to be condemning them. It's going to be criticizing them, right? I should have done something. I didn't. They know the right thing to do. And the flip side, the wrong thing to do. But this is not just a Christian idea either. Believe me, there'd be plenty of atheists that would jump in that river and try to save that child as well, right? All you have to do is look when there's a terrible earthquake in another part of the world where there's very little Christianity, and yet what do you see? You see everyone joining together, and they're trying to move blocks, and they're risking their own lives, digging through the rubble, trying to save lives. It's, oh, they must be all Christians. No, they're not. They're human beings. But why do we act this way? Because we're created by God, and he has given us this sense of right and wrong in our conscience. But this is where the biblical worldview is so important, because we also recognize sin. And our sin nature results in the fact that our conscience is no longer pure and perfect. If someone says, let your conscience be your guide, that's poor advice. It may not be right or wrong all the time, but you can't simply trust your conscience anymore. The only one, I guess, who could have trusted his conscience was Adam, because he was created sinless and perfect, and I guess Eve along with him. But once they sinned, they brought sin into the world and passed it on to all the offspring that followed them, which is everybody that's ever lived. And so we have that sin nature, don't we? So why is it that we can't trust our conscience? Because every time we make a choice that goes against God, our conscience gets a little harder. The Bible talks about getting to a point where your conscience is seared like fire over your skin, if you will. Think about seared flesh. If the burn is bad enough, one can lose all the sensitivity of the nerves, can't you? See, that's our conscience. It makes us sensitive to these things. But if our conscience gets harder and harder, seared and seared, then we lose that sensitivity, don't we? Why is it so much easier to lie than it would be like to steal something? I think the answer is because we've been doing it a lot longer. You start lying when you're a little child. You know it's wrong, you do it anyway. I mean, some big lies, a lot of small lies or whatever. And it's very easy to continue to do that from time to time. You have to force yourself to tell the truth, especially when telling the truth goes against your best interests. It's easy to tell the truth when it's in my best interest to do so. But why do people lie? Because it helps them out, gets them out of a jam, or, you know, makes their life a little easier. It's self, isn't it? Stealing comes a little bit harder because stealing's wrong too, just like telling a lie. But we've been doing that for a while, so stealing's still a lot easier than actually killing somebody. Because at some point you take what doesn't belong to you, probably as a child. You don't have to be a full-blown, kleptomaniac or whatever, but stealing has a lot of varieties. Stealing the employer's time, who's paying you to do the job, and you're just, playing video games on the computer or whatever instead of working. You know this is wrong. I don't want to get caught. Look around me, but I'm going to keep doing it. But killing somebody, that's very hard, and most people would refuse to do so. But isn't it also true? Someone who kills somebody actually takes that step, takes another innocent person's human life. We're not talking about, those rare situations, soldiers or police officer or whatever they have. I'm talking about one human being taking an innocent person's life, doing that, and that person, the murderer, will find it a little bit easier to do it the second time. And then the third time, and then the fourth time, and then you hear about these guys like, give me $10,000, I'll take them out. That's not probably the first person they've ever killed. So our conscience cannot be trusted in and of itself. And that's why we must bring it to the authority of God's word. I may think or feel that this is perfectly okay, but God's word says, no, it's not. Well, I've been doing it my whole life. I've never had to bring guilt over it. See, the other thing about our conscience, it's not just actually personally doing the action, but it can also be influenced by others. It's what indoctrination is all about. Say, look, there's nothing wrong with that. He does it, she does it, they do it. I mean, you've never actually done it yourself, but it's perfectly fine if you do one day. And you begin to think, oh, okay. And that also affects our conscience, doesn't it? And so we had to go to God's word. That is the authority. And so when Paul writes about the Gentiles, so you understand, first of all, what he's talking about. They don't have the law of Moses, but they're still creations of God. And in that limited revelation of God as a creator we talked about earlier, they've been given a conscience as well. But they don't follow it. Just like they were given the revelation of God as the creator through the planets and so forth, but they became idolaters. And then God gave them over to sinful behavior. And then they continued in it, and God gave them over even further. That was what chapter 1 was all about, wasn't it? And so when Paul's talking about how the Gentiles, they don't have the law of Moses, but by nature, by just naturally, they do those things. Naturally, they realize, hey, we shouldn't murder. If we're going to have a little village here, we can't kill each other. We can't steal each other from each other. When they do that by nature, it shows the law, God's moral standards written in their hearts, and then their conscience does its work. But now we're talking just like what we were talking about last week. Remember, we're looking at individual trees week by week, but the big picture of the forest here, remember back in talking about God's judgment, there's only two possibilities. He's going to reward you or he's going to judge you. And in verse 7 of chapter 2, just last Sunday, eternal life to those who by patient continuance in doing good seek for glory, honor, and immortality. And we discussed the idea, like, wait a minute, that sounds like a works righteousness sort of thing. It's like, yeah, it is. You mean someone can be saved by just living a good life? Yeah, if it's a perfect life. But that's the point. No one can. That's an impossibility. According to God's character, yes, but no one can meet that standard. That's the big picture that Paul is presenting to us, that we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. We're all guilty of God's judgment, and we'll all face it one day. And putting us in that position sets up the need for the Savior, and the introduction of that Savior is Jesus Christ and what he's done. See, that's what Paul is doing here. So likewise, in talking about the Gentiles, no one can say, well, they didn't have Bibles. They didn't have the law of Moses. Well, they had a conscience. Did they obey God perfectly using the conscience? No, they didn't. They had creation, but did they become idolaters? Yes, they did. So no, you can't blame God just because they had less revelation than Israel. Just like today, the church has got great revelation. There's people out there who don't know about Jesus and all that, but they still are accountable to God and his judgment for what they do know. God is going to be fair. He's going to be absolute just. He can't expect someone to know something that it's impossible for them to know. That's ridiculous. God would never act that way. But that doesn't mean people get a free pass either, because they're still guilty, and God holds them accountable for that. You see, a final word here, going back to the law of Moses. Remember I said how complex it was? There was another aspect to the law of Moses. Beyond the civil issues and the moral standards that are laid out in there, there was also the commandments to God's people, Israel, that they need to regularly bring these animal sacrifices. Sacrifices, these animals to be killed, their blood shed. And there were several types, but of course, key and most important was the sin offering. Here's the standards God gave them in the law, but the understanding and the expectation is they will not keep that. And they will be guilty in God's sight, but God is gracious and he's loving and forgiving and wants that righteous standard to forgive them. And so here, you go offer these sacrifices for your sin. And God laid all that out in the law of Moses as well. And that's what they did. Now, that blood that was shed from that animal hadn't sinned, you sinned. But the blood of that innocent animal that was shed, that was just a covering over your sin. It's like sweeping dirt under a rug. The dirt's still there. It's just out of sight while the rug is covering it. And that's what those animal sacrifices under the law did. They covered sin, but they didn't remove it. But we also recognize that what they were leading up to was the coming of Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. And when he shed his blood on the cross, his sacrifice for our sins and the sins of the entire world didn't just cover our sin, took it away forever, removed it. It's gone. And so all of those faithful Israelites who brought their sacrifices, they didn't do so thinking, I know one day, God, that the Son of God's going to come and die for my sins. They didn't have a clue. That's not why they came. We recognize the foreshadowing, the imagery, the symbolism of those animal sacrifices in Christ. But they just came by faith. They came by faith. God wants this. I want to obey him. And so I come by faith that this animal is going to do away with my sins and God will accept me into his presence. Why do you believe that thing? Because God said so. We come by faith to Jesus Christ. He said so, that his death would be for our sins. He rose from the dead on the third day, alive forevermore. And he says, whoever comes to me, I'll forgive. I won't cast out anybody. No matter how bad your sins are, the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from every sin. And the wonderful gift of eternal life is ours through faith in Christ. And then he says, now, all those people out there in the world who don't know this wonderful good news, I want you, church, who do know it, to go and tell them. They're trying to live according to their conscience and so forth, and they're failing miserably. And as their conscience gets harder and harder, a lot of them have just abandoned any pretext of obeying God. And they're certainly not living in faith. In fact, they're coming up with ideas and ways to explain the existence of life without God. But you have the truth, and I want you to tell them. But before we can tell anybody the truth, we have to receive it for ourselves, right? You will know the truth, Jesus said, and the truth will set you free. Free from the power, the bondage, and the consequences of our sins. That's the good news we have in Jesus Christ, that he died for our sins and rose from the dead. And if we will believe him, believe that he died for me, just like under the law of Moses, it wasn't good enough that your neighbor brought an animal. Hey, put in a good word for me, will you? With God, with that sacrifice you're offering? No, you had to bring your own. And it's one thing to say Jesus died for the sins of the whole world. Hallelujah. We have to personalize his death for our sins, my sins, your sins. He died for me. He rose for me. He's going to forgive me if I call on his name. And that's how it all begins, a life with God on this earth. Now, forgiven of our sins and empowered and led by his Spirit in our day-to-day choices, we still have that sin nature. And we're not trusting our conscience anymore because we've got something far greater than our conscience. We have the Holy Spirit of God indwelling us, and he convicts us of our right and wrong. And he will show us and he will give us wisdom if we will ask, and so much until the day that Jesus calls us. So Paul is, you know, that those last few minutes I just said, those are all coming in the next chapters, right? But right now, it's a very bleak, desolate picture. Whether you're God's chosen people, Israel, or whether you're those pagan Gentiles, we're all guilty of sin in God's sight, and we're all facing his judgment. But we know the good news, and we respond in simple childlike faith. Don't let the world try to snow you on, you know, well, how come you don't want to ban shellfish? It's like you just don't understand the law of Moses. It'd be like them saying, well, don't you want to bring back animal sacrifices? No, I don't want to bring back animal sacrifices. And I noticed that as soon as Jesus died and rose again, you never once see Peter or John, James, Matthew, any of them ever bring an animal sacrifice again. They still went to the temple to pray. Nothing wrong with praying at the temple while it was standing in Jerusalem. Jesus said, house of prayer. Eventually it was destroyed and there's no new temple, but no more animal sacrifices. They're not needed any longer because Jesus' sacrifice has paid the price for us all. Let's pray. Lord, how grateful we are. We thank you for that sacrifice. We thank you for the free gift of forgiveness of sins and eternal life through that shed blood, because we know, Lord, that we have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. I pray for everyone in our room here and who might be listening online that they trust you as Savior today, Lord, if they have not already. And help us to go forth with that biblical worldview on all aspects of life and our being, our creation. How important it is, Lord. And again, how knowing the truth under the authority of your word will spare us so much error and therefore so much misery and hardship. Bless as we go forth now. And help us to live lives that bring glory to your name through Jesus. We pray.